hello to all my BPTV fans, YouTube fans, and new fans. This is my 18th Talking Machine show. Of course, you know Alan Levine, the Talking Machine, is doing this show. I have another great guest for this 18th show, and I'm going to let him introduce himself right now.
Well, thank you, Alan. I'm pleased to be here. And my name is Lanny Frattare. For 33 years, I was a Pirates broadcaster. And since 2009, I've been a professor at Waynesburg University and one of the members of my Waynesburg University Hall of Fame, Sports Broadcasting Hall of Fame, is Nick Callis.
Yes, and that's one of the reasons you're here, because I had to brag about how you mentored this young man who grew up in Greentree and lives in Greentree, where I grew up. So you talk about the synchronicity of the universe.
Well, and I met him. I met Nick Callis when he was playing baseball for Keystone Oaks, and I was announcing a Keystone Oaks baseball game.
Wow, that's even better than
yeah,
I thought.
Yeah.
We're not going to bring Nick on. I do have him as a co-host Tuesday nights, so we'll leave him off air right now. He's on the camera right now to make us look great and sound great. So we'll carry on. Well, Lanny, it's great to have you on here. It's so cool.
Can I also say at the outset that, first of all, when I first came to Pittsburgh in 1976, I lived in Bethel Park.
Oh, get out.
On Cambridge Road.
I know it.
Okay. And then I also want to say that what's interesting about 2021 is I did about six Bethel Park baseball games.
Really?
The Bethel Park baseball team that won the championship, yeah, state championship, and got to know Pat Zender, the baseball coach, and his players really well, really well. Great guy.
That is so great.
Yeah, and
they
also
are. I had him on my show.
Well, I'm glad that you did.
Yeah, the whole
very,
team.
Very talented guy.
And the softball girls that won the championship.
I understand that. And then also I did about three or four Bethel Park football games.
You're kidding.
This fall. Got to know Brian DeLallo.
Yes.
Very well. And I should also thank Dan Sloan, who's the athletic director, because every time I would do a game in Bethel Park, his hospitality was phenomenal. And now I'm hoping that I'll get a chance to do basketball for Bethel Park.
Wow.
And by the way, Bethel Park High School, for those of you that don't know this, they don't have a gymnasium. They have an arena. It is a fabulous place to call a basketball
When they
game.
Got rid of the college campus and consolidated everything, what a place.
Though. Yeah, great place.
Truly.
Yes.
And I live like 2 minutes away from the high school. So I know it. I'm a big fan, and I'm glad you are too. And that's so special that you could share those little announcing duties that you had. Well, we're going to go way back in time. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Rochester, New York, which means that I grew up as a New York Yankees fan. And since the time I was 12 years old, I wanted to be a baseball announcer. Baseball was very much a part of our family. My dad ran the Little League, and I would listen a lot to Mel Allen, the voice of the New York Yankees, and to a guy named Tom Decker, who was the voice of our local team, the Rochester Red Wings.
Right.
And I was mesmerized by the baseball announcer.
Sure.
As a matter of fact, most times when I would go and see the Rochester Red Wings play, I would spend more time looking up at the press box, thinking to myself, that looks like the best seat in the house. And then years later, I found out that it is indeed the best seat in the house.
Yeah, for some coincidence, they make it that way. Very interesting.
It is great to not only have a chance to travel with the team and be a part and have that great
press
box.
Just the interactions of what you're doing with the team, too.
Yeah, it is. And by the way, that's one of the things I love best about high school football, high school basketball, and baseball, and softball, is that the athletic directors, the coaches, the student athletes, they are all so phenomenal,
right,
as it relates to helping me out, filling me in with information so that I can relate that information on
sure.
the air.
They want you to present it well.
Well, I hope I do. I admittedly
between I'm, us and you. He
well,
does.
No, but I, you know, to be honest with you, I'm an A plus baseball announcer. I'm about a B-minus basketball announcer,
okay,
and I'm a C-minus football announcer.
Whoa.
Yeah. But, those grades are about consistent with what I earned in high school and college.
Being consistent helps in life, as you know.
Oh, it is. Yes, indeed.
And that works out rather well. One thing we have in common is I grew up as a Yankee fan. And
you know, it took me the longest time to admit to Pittsburghers that I was rooting the other way in 1960.
Sure. Well, I was too young at the time. I was only 4 years old, so I didn't know which way was even up then.
No, I was in high school at the time, and remember where I was. I was in the audiovisual office watching the game. You know, back then, baseball played the World Series in the afternoon.
Did you have one of those little radios that...
Well, we had a TV in the audiovisual room.
So you were first class.
That's why I went there so I could watch the game. And as I said, I was rooting the other way. So.
No, I understand. And on my street, three doors up, the Camarda family, their dad was a huge Mickey Mantle fan. Mm-hmm. And his second son, he named him Mickey, M-I-C-K-E-Y, Mickey.
And my favorite player growing up was Yogi Berra.
Wow, what
because
a great
everybody
guy.
Everybody in my family was a catcher. And plus, I thought Yogi Berra looked a little bit like my dad. So there was an extremely natural connection there.
And look at all the World Series he won.
Yeah.
And what a great player he was. I mean, always sayings, people get distracted, but he had a great career.
Great ball. He was a great bad ball hitter.
Yeah.
And of course, one of the great trivia answers is, who was playing left field for the Yankees that day.
Right.
And then the other great question is, who was catching? If Yogi was in left field,
right,
then who was catching? And everybody has a tendency to say Elston Howard.
Yeah.
And it wasn't. It was Johnny Blanchard. So.
Wow. Thanks for the trivia coming out. I love trivia like that. No doubt. So where did you go to high school in Rochester?
Well, I went to a place called Charlotte High School. The school was named after the daughter of Nathaniel Rochester.
A connection.
And the great thing about it is that Charlotte High School was part of a community down by Lake Ontario.
Okay.
And so those of us who lived in the community, we really did feel the same way as people do with Bethel Park and Upper St. Clair and places like that.
Makes sense.
And so I had a tremendous childhood. And understand that because my parents knew that I wanted to be a baseball announcer.
Sure.
My dad did everything he possibly could to stimulate my interest. And I have an older brother. And so when I was 13, my brother was 17.
Okay.
And when my brother would play baseball, my dad would park the car so I could sit in the front seat of the car and announce the game.
No way.
And
you got
and,
the best dad.
Oh, and I did.
Especially looking like Yogi.
And because I didn't want to worry about my brother's players' teammates' names, I just made all of my brother's teammates Yankees.
No way.
So was Yogi Berra, Moose Scourin, Bobby Richardson, Tony Kubek, Mantle Maris, et cetera, et cetera.
So. You had them all covered.
I did, indeed.
So. No, that is great. Well, now you're on your way. Did you play any sports?
I played all three sports in high school, and I was absolutely terrible.
Okay.
I was quarterback of the football team. I played basketball. I was the sixth man. I was a catcher on the baseball team.
Of course, it's in your family.
What's that?
Catching's in your family.
It is. It is. But I was a terrible athlete. Matter of fact, I was such a bad athlete, and because my family was made up of great athletes.
Yeah.
I once had a guy say to me, "Are you adopted?" I was that bad. He said to me, because everybody else, my brothers, my uncles, my dad, they were all great athletes, and I came along and I was terrible. So.
Well, maybe.
But I played. I mean, I was starting quarterback. You know. So.
How was your mother's side of the family athletic-wise? You may have taken after her son.
I have no idea.
You may have.
And you're the first person to ever ask me that question, by the way, too.
Well, you know, half of your genes are your dad and your mom, so that's why I throw it out there. I dig deep. I told you, these are deep interviews.
Well, but I'll tell you what I did get from my parents, and particularly from my dad, is my dad was a very gregarious guy, very outgoing. And so that enhanced my communication skills. I learned a lot. I remember my dad would very often be MC for banquets, and I would be there, and I'd watch him do his thing. And
the life of the party.
He just was one. He liked to reach out to people. He was such a caring and giving individual, and I learned a lot from him about how to conduct myself as a person.
No, thanks for sharing that. So now you graduate, not really being an athlete. What's your next decision?
So I go to Ithaca College. I was trying to decide between Syracuse and Ithaca.
Okay.
And Syracuse, which, by the way, has one of the great broadcast schools
That's
in America.
That's what I've heard, yes.
But I thought Syracuse was going to be too big for me. And so I went to Ithaca, and I'm glad I did, and it was the perfect place for me. And I did try to play. I did play freshman football.
Okay.
Never got on the field. I played freshman baseball, and I had one at bat. And matter of fact, the only at bat I had was the last game of our freshman season. The guy who was the starting catcher went to the coach and said, "Lanny hasn't had an at bat. Let him pinch hit for me."
What a good guy.
Yeah, so, but that was my only, but like I said, I was.
I'm not going to ask how well you did.
No, I don't even remember. But the point being is, I mean, I was playing sports really because I wanted to announce, and I wanted to learn about the sports, and
right.
And so that's why I was doing it. And the satisfying point for me is that I was, an individual that found his way to the major leagues.
Sure.
By announcing.
Sure. No, that's so cool to talk about childhood dreams and achieving it. You know, we all have dreams. So.
Well, and that's why when I teach at Waynesburg, I talk to the students all the time about the fact that if you could have a passion for broadcasting. You know,
right.
it's interesting because I run across parents who say to me, that their young people are passionate about sports and
right.
therefore they think they would be a good announcer.
Right.
And I say no, it's not the same thing. You need to be passionate about announcing. Yes, the love for sports can find you or could
right.
help you
it can
get
give
to
you
that.
The guidance.
But
to
if
get
you're
there.
It's about being a sport, it's about announcing. It's about putting on the headsets and being passionate about that.
Sure. No, those are great points. No doubt. You got me pumped up. So now you're at Ithaca. What's next?
Well, and then I told you earlier that between between my freshman and sophomore years, I was applying to a TV station. The gentleman who auditioned me said I wasn't mature enough. My voice wasn't mature enough for the TV station, but he hired me to be disc jockey at a topless go-go place.
Understood.
At 19.
This is family friendly.
At 19.
This is a true story.
And I wasn't going to take the job, and then I went home and told my dad about it. And my dad said, well, hey, why not? You know, it's like vaudeville. Go ahead and,
yeah.
And I'm glad I did because, believe it or not, by way of the Pussycat, I met disc jockeys from the local radio station. They invited me up to the station. And a year later, I was on this radio station. So for 4 years, I became a disc jockey. When I graduated from Ithaca, I was a disc jockey for 4 years, and I wasn't very good at it.
Right.
And I knew I wanted to do baseball, and so then finally, I decided I got to move out of being a disc jockey. I had been public address announcer at the local baseball facility.
Right.
The Rochester Red Wings. And the guy that was general manager in Rochester decided to take a job in Charleston, West Virginia, and he asked me to go along as his radio broadcaster.
Wow.
And that was a tremendous break for me because the 2 years I was in Charleston, 1974, 1975, Charleston then was the AAA affiliate of the Pirates.
Oh, okay.
And one day I talked to the PR director of the Pirates, and he said to me, Lanny, on your way back from Charleston to Rochester, stop in Pittsburgh. I'll introduce you to Bob Prince.
You're kidding.
Okay. And not only was I introduced to Bob Prince, but I was sitting there and I was keeping score because I don't know how anybody can enjoy baseball and
without
not keep
the scorecard.
Keeping score. I don't understand how you can do that. But I was keeping score. And Bob Prince came over to me in the third inning and said to me, would you like to do an inning of play-by-play?
And just
I was flabbergasted because he didn't know. I mean, he didn't know if I could put two sentences together.
Right.
And he put me on the air, and that became a tremendous break for me because I did that in 74. I went back again in 75. He put me on the air again in 75.
Wow.
And not knowing that Bob Prince and Nellie King were going to get fired that year.
Right.
As a matter of fact, when I was there in 75, Nellie and Bob both talked to me about maybe being third man in their broadcast crew.
You're kidding.
So when Bob got fired, I thought my dream went down the drain with them.
Yeah.
And as it turned out, I did get the Pirates job in 76. And
what a segue into getting a job like that. You talk about being blessed.
Yeah, very blessed, thank God.
Yeah.
And so I had some talent, and I had a lot of great people looking out for me. And
you're building this great network that I can see by hook or by crook. somehow it worked out.
Hopefully there was nothing crooked about it.
Yes.
But I was very blessed, and and to have been a part of not only the Pirates, but be part of the Pirate, be part of the Pittsburgh community.
Yeah.
I mean, Pittsburgh is such a wonderful place, perfect place for me because of my mentality. You know, one of the things Bob Prince told me, he said, Lanny, as a Pirate broadcaster, you have to be more than just a voice on the air. And he said, you need to go out and do banquet appearances, et cetera. And so for 33 years, I averaged some 40 appearances every winter.
That is
going
great.
Going out to Meadville and Youngstown and Johnstown and
just
down into
state.
West Virginia just to meet people. Because Bob told me, so when you meet people and they get to meet you and hopefully you're a good guy and they like who you are, then they like you as a broadcaster.
Well, look at the legend Gunnar was.
Well, he was a phenomenal guy. And
I met him a couple times.
He was one of the most caring and giving people that
truly
you'll
was.
Ever want to meet. Yeah.
He had his wild side, but he did help many people.
I mean, I learned early on that I could take a lot of advice from Bob, but I couldn't be like Bob.
Yeah,
okay, I could only be me.
Who could be
Bob?
Definitely. Look at his jackets alone.
Oh, I know. So
right? No, some great memories. That is so cool.
But you know, the best thing about, and I get this asked this all the time, the best thing about my 33 years of Pirate broadcaster was the friendship I developed with Jim Leland. Have you ever met Jim?
Yes.
Okay, Jim Leland is, everybody should have a friend like Jim Leland. And what was remarkable about how our friendship developed is that at one point, I think it was the third year Jimmy was in Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
He started inviting me up to his suite after games on the road.
Wow.
And so I would be a part of discussions between Jimmy and his coaches about players. And I learned a lot about the team, and some of it he would tell me was off the record, and some of it wasn't off the record.
Sure.
And so
just very professional.
Oh, and Jimmy did so much for me. It was as I say, I don't think there are too many times where a broadcaster and a manager would be afforded the opportunity to have the friendship that Jim and I have had and still have, because even though Jimmy left the Pirates and managed other places,
right,
he never left Pittsburgh.
I know that.
He never left Pittsburgh. And
he put down some good roots here.
Matter of fact, I am godfather for Jim and Katie's son, Patrick.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah.
Wow.
When they were expecting Patrick, Jimmy came to me
and
said,
these are bonus issues that we're getting up here with Lanny.
Well, Jimmy came to me one day and said, Katie and I want you to be godson or godfather for our son. And well, what an honor that is.
Yeah.
Yeah, what an honor.
You can't refuse that.
No.
Right? No, these are great stories. I just love it. And I wanted to bring up Nellie King. I met him years later after listening to him and all that. And he was at some book signing thing. And I said, Nellie, I've always been a fan of yours. And he goes, I don't really remember a lot of people saying that. I go, I liked how...
I find that hard to believe. He's such a great guy.
And he was just so kind.
He was the perfect compliment for Bob Prince. That's
what I was telling him. I go, it was nice because you were like the balancing act between Bob.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
And I was so happy I got to talk to him, and it was just a great man, truly.
Yeah.
And it's amazing what we've had through sports. I grew up in a sports family and, you know, things like that. I had an uncle that was in 1945, first NBA team in Pittsburgh called the Pittsburgh Raiders. And you've heard of Myron Cope. My uncle's Jewish nickname was Shmuley, and he would say, the best basketball player in Pittsburgh plays like Bob Cousy, it's Shmuley Levine. So I grew up with that, and my dad, who was a great basketball referee, they were friends with Myron. When I'd come up and see him at an event, he'd go, the Levine boys are here. And how cool was that for memories, like what you're saying, with being around sports and the opportunities that have come up?
Yeah, exactly. I was, you know, I got to tell you one story about, there have been a lot of stories I
you
have
can
about
share
Jimmy
any
Leland.
Story,
but,
yeah.
But I got to tell you this. At one point with the Pirates, we had a president by the name of Mark Sauer.
Yeah.
And Mark and Georgia Sauer invited Jim and Katie Leland and Liz and me to dinner out in Franco's in Fox Chapel. And so while we're driving out to this dinner, and Jimmy decided to drive, Jimmy says to me, what do you make a year? And I told him,
yeah,
you know, first of all, you never lie to Jimmy Leland, and then when he asks you a question, you tell him
straight out.
Okay?
Yeah.
So I tell him, we get to dinner, and at one point at dinner, Jimmy looks at Mark Sauer and says, you know what, Lanny's underpaid. And I'm going, oh, my gosh. Oh, wow. Oh, my Lord.
Okay. I'm in trouble. Right.
That was a Thursday night. The following Monday, I get a call from Mark Sauer's secretary. Mark wants you to come in tomorrow. He wants to renegotiate your contract. How's that for friendship?
That's beyond friendship.
How's that
for
friendship?
Super. You got the magic there. No, that
I don't
great.
Have the magic. I just
you're
developed
right
a friendship with a wonderful man, and not only with Jim but with Katie and their son Patrick and their daughter Kelly. It means a lot to me.
And speaking of family, your wife is Liz.
My wife Liz died in December of 2020.
I'm so sorry to hear
that.
Yeah,
she died on Christmas Day. She had Alzheimer's. She was in a nursing home, and we're concerned that.
Yeah.
That some of the COVID affected her as well.
But, oh, sure.
But she and I, two children, a son David, who's a criminal investigator up in Cleveland.
Nice.
And David and his wife Anne Marie have two children. Spencer, who's 19, is a student with me at Waynesburg University and wants to follow in my footsteps. I have a granddaughter, Carly, who's going down to a Florida college in the fall of 2022.
Right.
And then my daughter Meg, who is a hairdresser, a very talented hairdresser, has a salon in South Hills Village Mall. She lives in Mount Lebanon. She has a 3-year-old son.
Oh, nice.
Gus. And so I am indeed a blessed man.
No, and I didn't ask where you live now.
I live over by Chartier's Country Club in Roslyn Farms.
I know where that's at.
Well, mainly because I love to play golf. I would play every day if I could.
Yeah.
I love to play golf. And I live near Chartier's Country Club, and so...
You're able to.
And not only does Chartier's have a great golf course, but swimming pool and all of that for my grandchildren and my children. And so it is the perfect place for me.
No, that is great. No, I wanted to hear some of that stuff. So you're close to the studio here. It was no problem.
No.
So, no, I appreciate it. What are some of your plans for the future? Because we're winding down. We got about 7 minutes to go. I know you always got something going on.
I do, in addition to teaching at Waynesburg, and I teach 2 days a week, I also do high school sports.
Right.
And I love to do it. Don Rebel, who is in charge of the, is one of the bosses of the Trib Live High School Sports Network,
okay.
along with Justin Labar. But it's Don that encouraged me to get involved in high school sports. And I'm glad I did, because Don is inspirational. His devotion to high school sports and to be a part of that team means a lot to me. I also do the Pony League World Series every year.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I do that every year, and I love doing it. I also have done West Virginia sports.
Wow.
I did some West Virginia basketball a couple years ago, and then this past spring I did West Virginia baseball. And a point back that I made before about the passion to put the headsets on. And not only the passion to announce the games, but the passion to prepare.
Sure.
You know, I teach my students, and I have no doubt that I'm right about this. 85% of the success of a broadcast is determined before you go on the air.
Really?
You know, as a matter of fact, when I do a high school football game on Friday nights, I put in 10 hours of preparation.
Okay.
And the students need to understand that they can't be effective on the air if they haven't done their homework and learned about the teams. And,
right.
You know, the worst thing in the world you want to do when you announce a high school game is to mispronounce a player's name.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, it'd be awful.
Especially,
it's terrible, okay?
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, what I love about it is the actively being involved with the call of the game, knowing that there are people that are listening to you and relying on you to provide
sure.
them with the information.
You're talking about their children.
Yeah, indeed. And what a great thing now with the internet and the chance for grandparents and aunts and uncles that can't be at the games to
sure.
tune in. So
sure.
it means
look at
a lot
what
to me.
You're learning about the players, the teams, and the friendships you're making, because I know you're unstoppable with friendships.
Well, I am. A couple things that I feel strongly about. First of all, I think laughter is one of the great gifts from
I'm
God.
I'm with you. Yeah.
I think laughter is one of the great gifts from God, and also the ability to develop relationships. I mean, serious friendships. Okay, there are a lot of people that say, you know, these people, they're friends. But I think there's a thin line, or maybe not it's even a thin line, between friendships and associations. And I'm blessed that I have so many great friends. And we were talking earlier about Jim Render, that football coach
right.
at Upper St. Clair, who's
exactly.
a dear friend of mine, and Jimmy Leland, and Jack Fala, who for years was the orthopedic doctor of the Pirates. And I'm back to that point about announcing is that it is I just love doing it, and I don't
sure.
As a matter of fact, when I do high school sports now, I get
yeah.
$50 a game.
Oh my goodness!
Okay, and because I don't do it for the money. Fortunately, as a
right.
Pirate announcer, I was overpaid.
Yeah,
and so
thanks to Jim Leland.
So now I'm in a position yeah. financially where I can do these other things that I love.
No, that is so great. No, thanks for sharing that. I'm trying to inspire others. Be like Lanny.
Well, I don't know about that, but
yeah.
I do have, and that's one of the things that means a lot to me, is the fact that I have a chance now to cultivate the next generation of communicators. And I have, and by the way, the best thing about teaching in Waynesburg, the absolute best thing, is the students. The
sure.
fact that I have developed some really outstanding relationship with young people. As a matter of fact, I get mad when I hear people criticizing this generation, because the young people that I've come across, that I've taught at Waynesburg, and I've been there 13 years now,
right.
are phenomenal young people. And we have a Christian university at Waynesburg.
Sure.
We have a very friendly, encompassing campus, and
yeah.
To be a part of that. And that's why I was so thrilled when my grandson Spencer decided to come to Waynesburg, because number one, I was excited about him wanting to follow in my footsteps, but two, I knew he was going to be a part of a real caring community.
Well, I talk about a legacy. You want to leave a legacy for the next generation, and then when you have your grandson want to follow your legacy, to me, that's off the charts. Truly, it is.
Well, it means a lot to me, yes.
No, it strikes you right in the heart. And I always think about acquaintances, because I worked in a union with a couple hundred people, and they'd go, "Aren't we friends?" And I go, "The way you swear and the way you talk, I'd never be a friend outside of here." And the guy kept going, "Aren't we friends?" I go, "No, we're acquaintances." And a couple guys go, "Ow, he doesn't understand what you're talking about."
Well, and I don't want to try to define friendships, but
doing it was black and white for
no,
me.
No, but I mean, when you think about the people that if you were in trouble, you could call.
Well, that's the personal thing.
Yeah,
yes.
And in the same way that you've sent the message to these individuals that are friends of yours, that you hope that if they're in trouble, they need something.
Right.
They will call and call on you to help them.
Well, and that's what I tell others that I'm friends with. If you need help, call. It's as simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
And we've covered a lot. We're down to the last minute. How do they get a hold of you to follow your exploits or anything?
Well, go to Waynesburg. The
13-year career there. So
indeed, and as I say, I've been blessed to have this opportunity to mentor young people, and I know, and by the way, if there's anybody that's thinking about a career in broadcasting and hasn't decided on a college yet, consider
Where?
Waynesburg, because I know I can teach a young person how to be a sportscaster. I know that.
If they have the passion.
Well, part of it, though, may be that once they get to Waynesburg, they learn a little bit about what it takes to develop that,
okay,
that
good
passion.
Point. Yeah, okay? Thanks for getting down to those points.
Yeah.
That's why I have you on here. It's been so great to interview you. I just appreciate
Thanks for inviting me. I appreciate you doing that. Thank you.
You're welcome. I had to meet you after I saw how professional Nick was and is. So that was one of my bonuses.
Thanks, talking machine.
And on that, please stay tuned. I hope you enjoyed this show. We'll be back again in 2 weeks. This was a great 18th Talking Machine show with Lanny Frattare. Take care, everyone.